A blessed year 2020, everyone. We close the painful chapter of 2019 to begin a new year. I've received quite a lot of messages wishing me happy 2020 from relatives and colleagues, and also some people will say compliments of the season. As I reflect on the year 2019, I realize the year 2019 was a mixed bag. Many of us were left with a lot of questions than answers. We wonder whether 2019 was a blessing or not because of our experience. The year had gone down in history with some great memories and disappointments. There were a lot of good memories in 2019, but all that was overshadowed with the challenges of the bad year. 2019 was a year in which, especially in politics here in England, which Labour was defeated by the Conservatives because of the Brexit argument. Nobody in politics will ever forget 2019. We tend to remember the painful part more than the good because of the scars which cannot be healed, which were left by the past year. We have all experienced some challenges. I will not talk of the loss of relatives, the loss of colleagues, the loss of friends. I will not talk of the loss of income, the loss of jobs, the collapse of business, the rebellion of children, the misfortune and the painful memories which has taken place. Personally, the year 2019 opened a new chapter in my life, and it gave me an experience that will carry me to eternity. However, it is those painful experiences that gave us a song in our hearts. Through those painful experiences, we've learned to be more closer to God. Through those challenging times, we've realized that God was more closer to us than ever before. Indeed, we called God when we were in trouble, and God fought our battles. Indeed, we realized that God was much closer to us, and we realized the reality and the power of God. We tested the goodness of God, and we realized that He truly loved His children. Many of us, we claimed the promise that we know most. We claimed the promise that we tend to sing when we're going through the valley of the shadow of fear and death. We remembered that our comforter, our great shepherd, is with us. I remember the book of Psalms chapter 46 verse 1, the promise which I called several times, especially towards the end of the year. The Bible says on Psalms chapter 46 verse 1, God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, will not we fear, though the earth be removed and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea, though the waters thereof roar and be troubled, though the mountains shake with the swelling thereof. The God of heaven is our refuge. He is the very present helper in times of need. He is always with us. In fact, in trouble, He said in Psalm chapter 50, verse 15, "And call upon me in the day of trouble, I will deliver thee, and thou shalt glorify me." We definitely have a testimony of how God delivered us, how God carried us, how God sustained us, how God supported us, how God was be with us in situations which cannot do anything. Personally, I called Him, remembering what He said in Isaiah chapter 40 verse 10, which is a promise that many of us know. The Bible says, "Fear thou not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee, yea, I will help thee, yea, I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness." This God is faithful and truthful, and definitely He was with us even in the challenging times. But you find that, you know, if the Lord was not on our side, it would have been a different story altogether. I say personally, if the Lord was not with me, it would have been a different case altogether. As Psalms chapter 124 verse 1 and 2 says, "If it had not been the Lord who was on our side, now may Israel say, if it had not been the Lord who was on our side when men rose up against us." If it was not the Lord who was on our side when we were involved in accidents, if it was not the Lord who was not our side when we went through those challenging situations, it would have been a different story altogether. But Verse 6 says, blessed be the Lord who has not given us as a prey to their teeth. Indeed, he protected us from our enemies. Indeed, he prevented us from terrible catastrophes that would have befallen on us. Indeed, he extricated us from the jaws of the evil one. The evil one wanted to destroy us. But however, the God of heaven was with us throughout. Through that painful experience, God was molding us, refining us, so that we could offer unto him an acceptable sacrifice. In fact, the book of Romans chapter 8, verse 28, the Bible says, and we know that all things work together for good to them that love the Lord, and to them that who are called according to his purpose. Therefore, you find that all these afflictions of the year 2019, it was all for our benefit. It was God controlling the temperature of the furnace so that we will not be destroyed. As we learn from Isaiah chapter 48, verse 10, the Bible says, behold, I have refined thee, but not with silver. I have chosen thee in the furnace of affliction. God allowed us to go through that situation. Verse 11 say, for my own sake. In fact, as we went through this problem, it was for God's sake. It was for our own sake. Even for my own sake will I do it. Why? So that God's name may be glorified. So that when we go through painful, challenging situation, we will learn to offer an acceptable sacrifice to God. Only the special, by the way, will go through this painful refining experience. Zechariah chapter 13, verse 9 says, and I'll bring the third part through the fire, and will refine them as silver is refined, and will try them as gold is tried. They shall call on my name, and I'll hear them. I will say, it is my people, and they shall say, the Lord is my God. Through pain, through challenging, through suffering, through difficulty, God was molding us so that we can be his children. But why did God allow such to happen? The Bible says in Malachi chapter 3, verse 3, and he shall sit as a refiner and purifier of silver, and he shall purify the sons of Levi, and purge them as gold and silver, that they may offer unto the Lord an offering in righteousness. Then shall the offering of Judah and Jerusalem be pleasant unto the Lord, as in the days of old, as in the former years. So God is sitting down as a refiner, refining his children in the furnace of affliction. And when we go through those afflictions, then we offer unto God an acceptable sacrifice. The Bible says in the book of Psalms chapter 119, this is the prayer of David. He says, they that fear thee will be glad when they see me. In fact, as David went through pain, as he went through challenging, he said, after that situation, then I'll have a testimony to share. Then they that fear thee will be glad when they see me, because I have hoped in thy word. I know, O Lord, that thy judgments are right, and that thou in righteousness hast afflicted me. Let, I pray thee, thy merciful kindness be for my comfort, according to thy word unto thy servant. Let thy tender mercies come unto me, that I may live, for thy law is my delight. Then what happened? Whatever has happened, the challenges and pain that we have gone through, it was for the good of our characters. It was for the good of the name of the Lord. It was for our development. It was for our experience. You know, my wife has got a song she enjoyed to listen to and sing. The song was written by this lady called Dottie Rambo long time ago in 1966. The song says, thank you for the valleys. It says, thank you for the valley I walked through today. The darker the valley, the more I learned to pray. I found you where the lilies are blooming by the way. And I thank you for the valley I walked through today. The valley, it's a very challenging place. It's a place of experience. It's a place of pain. It's a place where we don't want to be in. But she thanked God for the valley that she was walking through. It says in the chorus, thank you for every hill I climb. When we climb the hill, it's a time of joy and it's time of happiness. For every time the sun didn't shine in the time of sorrow, thank you for every lonely night. I pray until I knew that everything was all right. How we wrestled with God in prayer. How we soldiered in prayer. It was in those painful moments when the life was so difficult that we learned to pray, that we learned to wrestle with God, that we remained on our knees. And I thank you for the valley I walked through today. And then the last stanza said, life can be all sunshine or the flowers would die. The rivers would be all barren and dry. Life can be all blessing, for there will be no need to pray. So I thank you for the valley I walk through today. I thank God for the year 2019. For he taught me to depend upon God. I thank God for the year 2019. It taught me that I'm a human being. I thank God for the year 2019. It is that experience that has changed me and made me to be what I am today. But as I evaluate the year 2019, I ask myself some challenging question. I ask myself as a child of God, how will I remember 2019? How many people have I led to Christ in the year 2019? How many people did I mislead in the year 2019? How many people understood the love of God through me in the year 2019? How many lives did I change because of my conduct in the year 2019? Did I end the year with a good report in the eyes of God, or it's another thing? And as a preacher of the gospel, I asked myself some challenging question. Was I honest in my preaching and teaching? Did I rebuke in righteousness, or I feared that I may not be given another chance to preach again? Was I honest and faithful to the scripture, as the Bible says in Thessalonians 2 Timothy chapter 4 verse 2, preach the word. Be instant in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with all righteousness and doctrine. How is my preaching and my teaching recorded in heaven? Was I faithful? Was I truthful? Was I honest? Do I have something to be blamed of because of the way how I explained the scriptures? And as a bishop of the church, I asked my question, how many people did I visit in hospital? How was my ministry to the poor? How much time did I spend in prayer for the church of God? How much time did I spend in doing the ministry which gives edification to the saints? The Bible says in James chapter 1 verse 27, pure religion and undefiled before God and the Father is this, to visit the fatherless and the widows in their affliction and to keep himself unspotted from the world. How is my character today? But as a parent, I evaluate my commitment to my wife and children. How much time did I spend with my wife and my children? How much money was directed to my family? What lessons did I teach my children? How many times did I sit down with them to instruct them in righteousness according to the word of God? Did I train my children, or I neglected them? Was I a true father, or I was just a figure in the house? How was my responsibility? And as I start this new year, I seek to build on my previous experience. However, this is a great opportunity which God has given me to make my calling and my election sure, to correct my 2019 mistakes, to take up new challenges and responsibilities, to learn new skills, to graduate, to overcome sin and all forms of bad habits and inspiration. You know, inspiration says, Review and Herald, January 3rd, 1882. Let us enter upon the new year with a clean heart record. Let faults be corrected. Let bitterness and malice be uprooted. Let right triumph over wrong. Let envy and jealousy between brethren be put away. Hatred, honest confession will heal grave difficulties. Then with the love of God in the soul, they may flow from sincere lips the greeting, I wish you a happy new year.